Classic Tales presents Captain Blood by Raphael Sabatini. Unabridged narration by B.J. Harrison. Chapter 1. The Messenger. Peter Blood, bachelor of medicine and several other things besides, smoked a pipe and tended his geraniums, boxed on the sill of his window, above Water Lane in the town of Bridgwater. Sternly disapproving eyes considered him from a window opposite, but went disregarded. Mr. Blood's attention was divided between his task and the stream of humanity in the narrow street below, a stream which poured for the second time that day towards Castle Field, where earlier in the afternoon, Ferguson, the Duke's chaplain, had preached a sermon containing more treason than divinity. These straggling, excited groups were mainly composed of men with green boughs in their hats and the most ludicrous of weapons in their hands. Some, it is true, shouldered fowling pieces, and here and there a sword was brandished. But more of them were armed with clubs, and most of them trailed the mammoth pikes fashioned out of scythes, as formidable to the eye as they were clumsy to the hand. There were weavers, brewers, carpenters, smiths, masons, bricklayers, cobblers, and representatives of every other of the trades of peace among these improvised men of war. Bridgwater, like Taunton, had yielded so generously of its manhood to the service of the bastard Duke that for any to abstain whose age and strength admitted of his bearing arms was to brand himself a coward or a papist. Yet Peter Blood, who was not only able to bear arms, but trained and skilled in their use, who was certainly no coward, and a papist only when it so suited him, tended his geraniums and smoked his pipe on that warm July evening as indifferently as if nothing were afoot. One other thing he did. He flung after those war-fevered enthusiasts a line of Horace, a poet for whose work he had early conceived an inordinate affection. Quo, quo, celesti ruitis. And now, perhaps, you guess why the hot, intrepid blood inherited from the roving sires of his Somersetshire mother remained cool amidst all this frenzied, fanatical heat of rebellion. Why the turbulent spirit, which had forced him once from the sedate academical bonds his father would have imposed upon him, should now remain quiet in the very midst of turbulence. You realize how he regarded these men who were rallying to the banners of liberty, the banners woven by the virgins of Taunton, the girls from the seminaries of Miss Blake and Mrs. Musgrove, who, as the ballad runs, had ripped open their silk petticoats to make colors for King Monmouth's army. That Latin line, contemptuously flung after them as they clatter down the cobbled street, reveals his mind. To him, they were fools rushing in wicked frenzy upon their ruin. You see, he knew too much about this fellow Monmouth and the pretty brown slut who had borne him to be deceived by the legend of legitimacy, on the strength of which this standard of rebellion had been raised. He had read the absurd proclamation posted at the cross at Bridgwater, as it had been posted also at Taunton and elsewhere, setting forth that, upon the decease of our sovereign Lord Charles II, the right of succession to the crown of England, Scotland, France, and Ireland, with the dominions and territories thereunto belonging, did legally descend and devolve upon the most illustrious and high-born Prince James, Duke of Monmouth, son and heir apparent to the said King Charles II. It had moved him to laughter, as had the further announcement that James, Duke of York, did first cause the late king to be poisoned and immediately thereupon did usurp and invade the crown. He knew not which was the greater lie, for Mr. Blood had spent a third of his life in the Netherlands, where this James Scott, who now proclaimed himself James II, by the grace of God, King, etc., first saw the light some 36 years ago, and he was acquainted with the story current there of the fellow's real paternity, far from being legitimate by virtue of a pretended secret marriage between Charles Stuart and Lucy Walter. It was possible that this Monmouth, who now proclaimed himself King of England, was not even the illegitimate child of the late sovereign. What but ruin and disaster could be the end of this grotesque pretension? How could it be hoped that England would ever swallow such a Perkin? And it was on his behalf to uphold his fantastic claim that these West Country clods, led by a few armigerous Whigs, had been seduced into rebellion. Quo, quo, celesti ruitis. He laughed and sighed in one. But the laugh dominated the sigh, for Mr. Blood was unsympathetic, as are most self-sufficient men, and he was very self-sufficient. Adversity had taught him so to be. A more tender-hearted man, possessing his vision and his knowledge, might have found cause for tears in the contemplation of these ardent, simple, nonconformist sheep going forth to the shambles, escorted to the rallying ground on Castle Field by wives and daughters, sweethearts and mothers, sustained by the delusion that they were to take the field in defense of right, of liberty, and of religion. For he knew, as all Bridgwater knew, and had known now for some hours, that it was Monmouth's intention to deliver battle that same night. The Duke was to lead a surprise attack upon the Royalist army under Feversham that was now encamped on Sedgemoor. Mr. Blood assumed that Lord Feversham would be equally well informed, and if, in this assumption, he was wrong, at least he was justified of it. He was not to suppose the Royalist commander so indifferently skilled in the trade he followed. Mr. Blood knocked the ashes from his pipe and drew back to close his window. As he did so, his glance, traveling straight across the street, met at last the glance of those hostile eyes that watched him. There were two pairs, and they belonged to the Mrs. Pitt, two amiable, sentimental maiden ladies who yielded to none in Bridgwater in their worship of the handsome Monmouth. Mr. Blood smiled and inclined his head, for he was on friendly terms with these ladies, one of whom, indeed, had been for a little while his patient. But there was no response to his greeting. Instead, the eyes gave him back a stare of cold disdain. The smile on his thin lips grew a little broader, a little less pleasant. He understood the reason of that hostility, which had been daily growing in this past week since Monmouth had come to turn the brains of women of all ages. The Mrs. Pitt, he apprehended, contemned now that he, a young and vigorous man, of a military training which might now be valuable to the cause, should stand aloof, that he should placidly smoke his pipe and tend his geraniums on this evening of all evenings, when men of spirit were rallying to the Protestant champion, offering their blood to place him on the throne where he belonged. If Mr. Blood had condescended to debate the matter with these ladies, he might have urged that having had his fill of wandering and adventuring, he was now embarked upon the career for which he had been originally intended, and for which his studies had equipped him. That he was a man of medicine and not of war, a healer, not a slayer. But they would have answered him, he knew, that in such a cause it behoved every man who deemed himself a man to take up arms. They would have pointed out that their own nephew Jeremiah, who was by trade a sailor, the master of a ship, which by an ill chance for that young man had come to anchor at this season in Bridgwater Bay, had quitted the helm to snatch up a musket in defense of right. But Mr. Blood was not of those who argue. As I have said, he was a self-sufficient man. He closed the window, drew the curtains, and turned to the pleasant, candle-lighted room, and the table on which Mrs. Barlow, the housekeeper, was in the very act of spreading supper. To her, however, he spoke aloud his thought. "It's out of favor I am with the vinegary virgins over the way." He had a pleasant, vibrant voice, whose metallic ring was softened and muted by the Irish accent, which in all his wanderings he had never lost. It was a voice that could woo seductively and caressingly, or command in such a way as to compel obedience. Indeed, the man's whole nature was in that voice of his. For the rest of him, he was tall and spare, swarthy of tint as a gypsy, with eyes that were startlingly blue in that dark face and under those level black brows. In their glance, those eyes, flanking a high-bridged, intrepid nose, were of singular penetration and of a steady haughtiness that went well with his firm lips. Though dressed in black, as became his calling, yet it was with an elegance derived from the love of clothes that is peculiar to the adventurer he had been, rather than to the staid medicus he now was. His coat was of fine camlet, and it was laced with silver. There were ruffles of Mechlin at his wrists, and a Mechlin cravat encased his throat. His great black periwig was as sedulously curled as any at Whitehall. Seeing him thus, and perceiving his real nature, which was plain upon him, you might have been tempted to speculate how long such a man would be content to lie by in this little backwater of the world, into which chance had swept him some 6 months ago, how long he would continue to pursue the trade for which he had qualified himself before he had begun to live. Difficult of belief, though it may be, when you know his history, previous and subsequent, yet it is possible that but for the trick that fate was about to play him, he might have continued this peaceful existence, settling down completely to the life of a doctor in this Somersetshire haven. It is possible, but not probable. He was the son of an Irish medicus, by a Somersetshire lady in whose veins ran the rover blood of the Frobishers, which may account for a certain wildness that had early manifested itself in his disposition. This wildness had profoundly alarmed his father, who, for an Irishman, was of a singularly peace-loving nature. He had early resolved that the boy should follow his own honorable profession, and Peter Blood, being quick to learn and oddly greedy of knowledge, had satisfied his parent by receiving at the age of 20 the degree of Baccalaureus Medicinae at Trinity College, Dublin. His father survived that satisfaction by 3 months only. His mother had then been dead some years already. Thus, Peter Blood came into an inheritance of some few £100, with which he had set out to see the world and give for a season a free rein to that restless spirit by which he was imbued. A set of curious chances led him to take service with the Dutch, then at war with France, and a predilection for the sea made him elect that this service should be upon that element. He had the advantage of a commission under the famous de Ruyter, and fought in the Mediterranean engagement in which that great Dutch admiral lost his life. After the peace at Nijmegen, his movements are obscure, but we know that he spent 2 years in a Spanish prison, though we do not know how he contrived to get there. It may be due to this that upon his release he took up his sword to France and saw service with the French in their warring upon the Spanish Netherlands. Having reached, at last, the age of 32, his appetite for adventure surfeited, his health having grown indifferent as a result of a neglected wound, he was suddenly overwhelmed by homesickness. He took ship from Nantes with intent to cross to Ireland, but the vessel, being driven by stress of weather into Bridgwater Bay, and Blood's health having grown worse during the voyage, he decided to go ashore there, additionally urged to it by the fact that it was his mother's native soil. Thus, in January of that year, 1685, he had come to Bridgwater, possessor of a fortune that was approximately the same as that with which he had originally set out from Dublin 11 years ago. Because he liked the place in which his health was rapidly restored to him, and because he conceived that he had passed through adventures enough for a man's lifetime, he determined to settle there and take up at last the profession of medicine from which he had, with so little profit, broken away. That is all his story, or so much of it as matters up to that night, 6 months later, when the Battle of Sedgemoor was fought. Deeming the impending action no affair of his, as indeed it was not, and indifferent to the activity with which Bridgwater was that night agog, Blood closed his ears to the sounds of it and went early to bed. He was peacefully asleep long before 11 o'clock, at which hour, as you know, Monmouth rode out with his rebel host along the Bristol Road, circuitously to avoid the marshland that lay directly between himself and the royal army. You also know that his numerical advantage, possibly counterbalanced by the greater steadiness of the regular troops on the other side, and the advantages he derived from falling by surprise upon that army that was more or less asleep, were all lost to him by blundering and bad leadership before ever he was at grips with Feversham. The armies came into collision in the neighborhood of 2 o'clock in the morning, Mr. Blood slept undisturbed through the distant boom of cannon. Not until 4 o'clock, when the sun was rising to dispel the last wisps of mist over that stricken field of battle, did he awaken from his tranquil slumbers. He sat up in bed, rubbed the sleep from his eyes, and collected himself. Blows were thundering upon the door of his house, and a voice was calling incoherently. This was the noise that had aroused him. Conceiving that he had to do with some urgent obstetrical case, he reached for bedgown and slippers to go below. On the landing, he almost collided with Mrs. Barlow, new-risen and unsightly, in a state of panic. He quieted her cluckings with a word of reassurance and went himself to open. There, in the slanting golden light of the new-risen sun, stood a breathless, wild-eyed man and a steaming horse, smothered in dust and grime, his clothes in disarray, the left sleeve of his doublet hanging in rags. This young man opened his lips to speak, yet for a long moment remained speechless. In that moment, Mr. Blood recognized him for the young shipmaster Jeremiah Pitt, the nephew of the maiden ladies opposite, one who had been drawn by the general enthusiasm into the vortex of that rebellion. The street was rousing, awakened by the sailors' noisy advent. Doors were opening and lattices were being unlatched for the protrusion of anxious, inquisitive heads. "Take your time now," said Mr. Blood. "I never knew speed made by overhaste." But the wild-eyed lad paid no heed to the admonition. He plunged headlong into speech, gasping, breathless.
"It is Lord Gildoy," he panted. "He is sore wounded. At Oglethorpe's farm by the river, I bore him thither, and he sent me for you. Come away, come away!"
He would have clutched the doctor and haled him forth by force in bedgown and slippers as he was, but the doctor eluded that too eager hand. "To be sure, I'll come," said he. He was distressed. Gildoy had been a very friendly, generous patron to him since his settling in these parts, and Mr. Blood was eager enough to do what he now could to discharge the debt, grieved that the occasion should have arisen, and in such a manner, for he knew quite well that the rash young nobleman had been an active agent of the Duke's. "To be sure, I'll come. But first give me leave to get some clothes and other things that I may need."
"There's no time to lose."
"Be easy now. I'll lose none. I tell ye again, you'll go quickest by going leisurely. Come in, take a chair." He threw open the door of a parlor. Young Pitt waved aside the invitation.
"I'll wait here. Make haste, in God's name."
Mr. Blood went off to dress and to fetch a case of instruments. Questions concerning the precise nature of Gildoy's hurt could wait until they were on their way. Whilst he pulled on his boots, he gave Mrs. Barlow instructions for the day, which included the matter of a dinner he was not destined to eat. When at last he went forth again, Mrs. Barlow clucking after him like a disgruntled fowl, he found young Pitt smothered in a crowd of scared, half-dressed townsfolk, mostly women, who had come hastening for news of how the battle had sped. The news he gave them was to be read in the lamentations with which they disturbed the morning air. At sight of the doctor, dressed and booted, the case of instruments tucked under his arm, the messenger disengaged himself from those who pressed about, shook off his weariness and the two tearful aunts that clung most closely, and seizing the bridle of his horse, he climbed to the saddle.
"Come along, sir," he cried. "Mount behind me."
Mr. Blood, without wasting words, did as he was bidden. Pitt touched the horse with his spur. The little crowd gave way, and thus, upon the crupper of that doubly laden horse, clinging to the belt of his companion, Peter Blood set out upon his odyssey. For this Pitt, in whom he beheld no more than the messenger of a wounded rebel gentleman, was indeed the very messenger of fate. Chapter 2. Kirke's Dragoons. Oglethorpe's farm stood a mile or so to the south of Bridgwater on the right bank of the river. It was a straggling Tudor building, showing grey above the ivy that clothed its lower parts. Approaching it now, through the fragrant orchards amid which it seemed to drowse in Arcadian peace beside the waters of the Parrot, sparkling in the morning sunlight, Mr. Blood might have had a difficulty in believing it part of a world tormented by strife and bloodshed. On the bridge, as they had been riding out to Bridgwater, they had met a vanguard of fugitives from the field of battle, weary, broken men, many of them wounded, all of them terror-stricken, staggering in speedless haste with the last remnants of their strength into the shelter which it was their vain illusion the town would afford them. Eyes glazed with lassitude and fear, looked up piteously out of haggard faces at Mr. Blood and his companion as they rode forth. Hoarse voices cried a warning that merciless pursuit was not far behind. Undeterred, however, young Pitt rode amain along the dusty road by which these poor fugitives from that swift rout on Sedgemoor came flocking in ever-increasing numbers. Presently he swung aside, and quitting the road, took to a pathway that crossed the dewy meadowlands. Even here they met odd groups of these human derelicts, who were scattering in all directions, looking fearfully behind them as they came through the long grass, expecting at every moment to see the red coats of the dragoons. But as Pitt's direction was a southward one, bringing them ever nearer to Feversham's headquarters, they were presently clear of that human flotsam and jetsam of the battle, and riding through the peaceful orchards, heavy with the ripening fruit that was soon to make its annual yield of cider. At last they alighted on the kidney stones of the courtyard, and Baines, the master of the homestead, grave of countenance and flustered of manner, gave them welcome. In the spacious stone-flagged hall, the doctor found Lord Gildoy, a very tall and dark young gentleman, prominent of chin and nose, stretched on a cane daybed under one of the tall, mullioned windows, in the care of Mrs. Baines and her comely daughters. His cheeks were leaden-hued, his eyes closed, and from his blue lips came with each labored breath a faint, moaning noise. Mr. Blood stood for a moment, silently considering his patient. He deplored that a youth with such bright hopes in life as Lord Gildoy's should have risked all, perhaps existence itself, to forward the ambition of a worthless adventurer. Because he had liked and honored this brave lad, he paid his case the tribute of a sigh. Then he knelt to his task, ripped away doublet and underwear to lay bare his lordship's mangled side, and called for water and linen and what else he needed for his work. He was still intent upon it a half hour later when the dragoons invaded the homestead. The clatter of hooves and hoarse shouts that heralded their approach disturbed him not at all. For one thing, he was not easily disturbed. For another, his task absorbed him. But his lordship, who had now recovered consciousness, showed considerable alarm, and the battle-stained Jeremy Pitt sped to cover in the clothes press. Baines was uneasy, and his wife and daughter trembled. Mr. Blood reassured them. "Why, what's to fear?" he said. "It's a Christian country, this, and Christian men do not make war upon the wounded, nor upon those who harbor them." He still had, you see, illusions about Christians. He held a glass of cordial, prepared under his directions to his lordship's lips. "Give your mind peace, my lord. The worst is done." And then they came rattling and clanking into the stone-flagged hall, a round dozen jack-booted, lobster-coated troopers of the Tangiers regiment, led by a sturdy, black-browed fellow with a deal of gold lace about the breast of his coat. Baines stood his ground, his attitude half-defiant, whilst his wife and daughter shrank away in renewed fear. Mr. Blood, at the head of the daybed, looked over his shoulder to take stock of the invaders. The officer barked an order, which brought his men to an attentive halt, then swaggered forward, his gloved hand bearing down the pummel of his sword, his spurs jingling musically as he moved. He announced his authority to the yeoman.
"I am Captain Hobart, of Lord Kirke's dragoons. What rebels do you harbor?"
The yeoman took alarm at that ferocious truculence. It expressed itself in his trembling voice.
I am no harborer of rebels, sir. This wounded gentleman..."
"I can see for myself."
The captain stamped forward to the daybed and scowled down upon the grey-faced sufferer.
"No need to ask how he came in this state and by his wounds. A damned rebel, and that's enough for me."
He flung a command at his dragoons.
"Out with him, my lads."
Mr. Blood got between the daybed and the troopers.
"In the name of humanity, sir," said he on a note of anger, "this is England, not Tangiers. The gentleman is in sore case. He may not be moved without peril to his life."
Captain Hobart was amused.
Oh, I am to be tender of the lives of these rebels. Odd's blood! Do you think it's to benefit his health we're taking him? There's gallows being planted along the road from Western to Bridgwater, and he'll serve for one of them as well as another. Colonel Kirke'll learn these non-conforming oafs something they'll not forget in generations.
You're hanging men without trial? Faith, then it's mistaken I am. We're in 10 years after all, it seems, where your regiment belongs. The captain considered him with a kindling eye. He looked him over from the soles of his riding boots to the crown of his periwig. He noted the spare, active frame, the arrogant poise of the head, the air of authority that invested Mr. Blood, and soldier recognized soldier. The captain's eyes narrowed. Recognition went further.
"Who the hell may you be?"
he exploded. "My name is Blood, sir. Peter Blood, at your service."
"Aye, aye. Codso, that's the name. You were in French service once, were you not?"
If Mr. Blood was surprised, he did not betray it. "I was."
"Then I remember you. 5 years ago, or more, you were in Tangiers."
"That is so. I knew your colonel."
"Faith, you may be renewing the acquaintance."
The captain laughed unpleasantly.
"What brings you here, sir?"
"This wounded gentleman. I was fetched to attend him. I am a medicus."
"A doctor? You?"
Scorn of that lie, as he conceived it, rang in the heavy, hectoring voice. "Medicinae baccalaureus," said Mr. Blood.
"Don't fling your French at me, man," snapped Hobart. "Speak English."
Mr. Blood's smile annoyed him. "I am a physician, practicing my calling in the town of Bridgwater." The captain sneered.
"Which you reached by way of Lyme Regis in the following of your bastard Duke."
It was Mr. Blood's turn to sneer. "If your wit were as big as your voice, my dear, it's the great man you'd be by this." For a moment the dragoon was speechless. The color deepened in his face.
"You may find me great enough to hang you."
"Faith, yes. You've the look and the manners of a hangman. But if you practice your trade on my patient here, you may be putting a rope round your own neck. He's not the kind you may string up and no questions asked. He has the right to trial, and the right to trial by his peers."
"By his peers?"
The captain was taken aback by these three words, which Mr. Blood had stressed. "Sure now, any but a fool or a savage would have asked his name before ordering him to the gallows. The gentleman is my Lord Gildoy."
And then his lordship spoke for himself in a weak voice.
"I make no concealment of my association with the Duke of Monmouth. I'll take the consequences. But if you please, I'll take them after trial by my peers, as the doctor has said."
The feeble voice ceased, and was followed by a moment's silence. As in common in many blustering men, there was a deal of timidity deep down in Hobart. The announcement of his lordship's rank had touched those depths. A servile upstart, he stood in awe of titles. And he stood in awe of his colonel. Percy Kirke was not lenient with blunderers. By a gesture, he checked his men. He must consider. Mr. Blood, observing his pause, added further matter for his consideration. "You'll be remembering, Captain. The Lord Gildoy will have friends and relatives on the Tory side, who'll have something to say to Colonel Kirke if his lordship should be handled like a common felon. You'll go warily, Captain. Or, as I've said, it's a halter for your neck you'll be weaving this morning." Captain Hobart swept the warning aside with a bluster of contempt, but he acted upon it nonetheless.
"Take up the daybed," said he, "and convey him on that to Bridgwater. Lodge him in the jail until I take order about him."
"He may not survive the journey," Blood remonstrated. "He's in no case to be moved."
"So much the worse for him. My affair is to round up rebels."
He confirmed his order by a gesture. Two of his men took up the daybed and swung to depart with it. Gildoy made a feeble effort to put forth a hand towards Mr. Blood.
"Sir,"
he said,
"you leave me in your debt. If I live, I shall study how to discharge it."
Mr. Blood bowed for answer. Then to the men, "Bear him steadily," he commanded. "His life depends on it." As his lordship was carried out, the captain became brisk. He turned upon the yeoman.
"What other cursed rebels do you harbour?"
"No other, sir. His lordship..."
"We've dealt with his lordship for the present. We'll deal with you in a moment when we've searched your house. And by God, if you've lied to me...
He broke off, snarling, to give an order. Four of his dragoons went out. In a moment, they were heard moving noisily in the adjacent room. Meanwhile, the captain was questing about the hall, sounding the wainscoting with the butt of a pistol. Mr. Blood saw no profit to himself in lingering. "By your leave, it's a very good day I'll be wishing you," said he.
"By my leave, you'll remain a while,"
the captain ordered him. Mr. Blood shrugged and sat down. "You're tiresome," he said. "I wonder your colonel hasn't discovered it yet." But the captain did not heed him. He was stooping to pick up a soiled and dusty hat, in which there was pinned a little bunch of oak leaves. It had been lying near the clothes press in which the unfortunate Pitt had taken refuge. The captain smiled malevolently. His eyes raked the room, resting first sardonically on the yeoman, then on the two women in the background, and finally on Mr. Blood, who sat with one leg thrown over the other in an attitude of indifference that was far from reflecting his mind. Then the captain stepped to the press and pulled open one of the wings of its massive oaken door. He took the huddled inmate by the collar of his doublet and lugged him out into the open.
"And who the devil's this?"
quoth he.
"Another nobleman?"
Mr. Blood had a vision of those gallows of which Captain Hobart had spoken, and of this unfortunate young shipmaster going to adorn one of them, strung up, without trial, in the place of the other victim of whom the captain had been cheated. On the spot, he invented not only a title, but a whole family for the young rebel. "Faith, you've said it, Captain. This is Viscount Pitt, first cousin to Sir Thomas Vernon, who is married to the slut Moll Kirke, sister to your own colonel, and sometime lady-in-waiting upon King James's queen." Both the captain and his prisoner gasped. But whereas thereafter young Pitt discreetly held his peace, the captain rapped out a nasty oath. He considered the prisoner again.
"He's lying, is he not?"
he demanded, seizing the lad by the shoulder and glaring into his face.
"He's rallying me, by God!"
"If you believe that," said Blood, "hang him and see what happens to you." The dragoon glared at the doctor, and then at his prisoner.
"Pah!"
He thrust the lad into the hands of his men.
"Fetch him along to Bridgwater, and make fast that fellow also."
He pointed to Baines.
"We'll show him what it means to harbour and comfort rebels."
There was a moment of confusion. Baines struggled in the grip of the troopers, protesting vehemently. The terrified women screamed until silenced by a greater terror. The captain strode across to them. He took the girl by the shoulders. She was a pretty, golden-haired creature, with soft blue eyes that looked up entreatingly, piteously into the face of the dragoon. He leered upon her, his eyes aglow, took her chin in his hand and set her shuddering by his brutal kiss.
"It's an earnest,"
he said, smiling grimly.
"Let that quiet you, little rebel, till I've done with these rogues."
And he swung away again, leaving her faint and trembling in the arms of her anguished mother. His men stood, grinning, awaiting orders, the two prisoners now fast pinioned.
"Take them away! Let Cornet Drake have charge of them."
His smoldering eye again sought the cowering girl.
"I'll stay a while to search out this place. There may be other rebels hidden here."
As an afterthought, he added,
"And take this fellow with you."
He pointed to Blood.
"Bestir!"
Mr. Blood started out of his musings. He had been considering that in his case of instruments there was a lancet with which he might perform on Captain Hobart a beneficial operation. Beneficial, that is, to humanity. In any case, the dragoon was obviously plethoric and would be the better for a bloodletting. The difficulty lay in making the opportunity. He was beginning to wonder if he could lure the captain aside with some tale of hidden treasure when this untimely interruption set a term to that interesting speculation. He sought to temporize. "Faith, it will suit me very well," said he, "for Bridgwater is my destination, and but that ye detained me, I'd have been on my way thither now."
"Your destination there will be the jail."
"Ah, bah, you're surely joking."
"There's a gallows for you if you prefer it. It's merely a question of now or later."
Rude hands seized Mr. Blood, and that precious lancet was in the case on the table out of reach. He twisted out of the grip of the dragoons, for he was strong and agile, but they closed with him again immediately and bore him down. Pinning him to the ground, they tied his wrists behind his back, then roughly pulled him to his feet again.
Take him away,
said Hobart shortly, and turned to issue his orders to the other waiting troopers.
Go search the house from attic to cellar, then report to me here.
The soldiers trailed out by the door leading to the interior. Mr. Blood was thrust by his guards into the courtyard, where Pitt and Baines already waited. From the threshold of the hall, he looked back at Captain Hobart, and his sapphire eyes were blazing. On his lips trembled a threat of what he would do to Hobart if he should happen to survive this business. Betimes, he remembered that to utter it were probably to extinguish his chance of living to execute it. For today the king's men were masters in the West, and the West was regarded as enemy country, to be subjected to the worst horror of war by the victorious side. Here a captain of horse was for the moment lord of life and death. Under the apple trees in the orchard, Mr. Blood and his companions in misfortune were made fast each to a trooper's stirrup leather. Then, at the sharp order of the cornet, the little troop started for Bridgwater. As they set out, there was the fullest confirmation of Mr. Blood's hideous assumption that, to the dragoons, this was a conquered enemy country. There were sounds of rending timbers, of furniture smashed and overthrown, the shouts and laughter of brutal men to announce that this hunt for rebels was no more than a pretext for pillage and destruction. Finally, above all other sounds came the piercing screams of a woman in acutest agony. Baines checked in his stride and swung round, writhing, his face ashen. As a consequence, he was jerked from his feet by the rope that attached him to the stirrup leather, and he was dragged helplessly a yard or two before the trooper reined in, cursing him foully and striking him with the flat of his sword. It came to Mr. Blood, as he trudged forward under the laden apple trees on that fragrant, delicious July morning, that man, as he had long suspected, was the vilest work of God, and that only a fool would set himself up as a healer of a species that was best exterminated. Chapter 3. The Lord Chief Justice. It was not until 2 months later, on the 19th of September, if you will have the actual date, that Peter Blood was brought to trial upon a charge of high treason. We know that he was not guilty of this, but we need not doubt that he was quite capable of it by the time he was indicted. Those 2 months of inhuman, unspeakable imprisonment had moved his mind to a cold and deadly hatred of King James and his representatives. It says something for his fortitude that in all the circumstances he should still have a mind at all. Yet, terrible as was the position of this entirely innocent man, he had cause for thankfulness on 2 counts. The first of these was that he should have been brought to trial at all. The second, that his trial took place on the date named and not a day earlier. In the very delay which exacerbated him lay, although he did not realize it, his only chance of avoiding the gallows. Easily, but for the favor of fortune, he might have been one of those hailed on the morrow of the battle, more or less haphazard from the overflowing jail at Bridgwater, to be summarily hanged in the marketplace by the bloodthirsty Colonel Kirke. There was about the colonel of the Tangiers regiment a deadly dispatch, which might have disposed in like fashion of all those prisoners, numerous as they were, but for the vigorous intervention of Bishop Mews, which put an end to the drumhead courts-martial. Even so, in that first week after Sedgemoor, Kirke and Feversham contrived between them to put to death over 100 men after a trial so summary as to be no trial at all. They required human freights for the gibbets with which they were planting the countryside, and they little cared how they procured them or what innocent lives they took. What, after all, was the life of a clod? The executioners were kept busy with rope and chopper and cauldrons of pitch. I spare you the details of that nauseating picture. It is, after all, with the fate of Peter Blood that we are concerned, rather than that of the Monmouth rebels. He survived to be included in one of those melancholy droves of prisoners who, chained in pairs, were marched from Bridgwater to Taunton. Those who were too sorely wounded to march were conveyed in carts, into which they were brutally crowded, their wounds undressed and festering. Many were fortunate enough to die upon the way. When Blood insisted upon his right to exercise his art so as to relieve some of this suffering, he was accounted importunate and threatened with a flogging. If he had one regret now, it was that he had not been out with Monmouth. That, of course, was illogical, but you can hardly expect logic from a man in his position. His chain companion on that dreadful march was the same Jeremy Pitt, who had been the agent of his present misfortunes. The young shipmaster had remained his close companion after their common arrest. Hence, fortuitously, they had been chained together in the crowded prison, where they were almost suffocated by the heat and the stench during those days of July, August, and September. Scraps of news filtered into the jail from the outside world. Some may have been deliberately allowed to penetrate. Of these was the tale of Monmouth's execution. It created profoundest dismay among those men who were suffering for the Duke and for the religious cause he had professed to champion. Many refused utterly to believe it. A wild story began to circulate that a man resembling Monmouth had offered himself up in the Duke's stead, and that Monmouth survived to come again in glory to deliver Zion and make war upon Babylon. Mr. Blood heard that tale with the same indifference with which he had received the news of Monmouth's death. But one shameful thing he heard in connection with this, which left him not quite so unmoved, and served to nourish the contempt he was forming for King James. His Majesty had consented to see Monmouth. To have done so, unless he intended to pardon him, was a thing execrable and damnable beyond belief, for the only other object in granting that interview would be the evilly mean satisfaction of spurning the abject penitence of his unfortunate nephew. Later they heard that Lord Grey, who after the Duke, indeed, perhaps before him, was the main leader of the rebellion, had purchased his own pardon for £40,000. Peter Blood found this of a piece with the rest. His contempt for King James blazed out at last. "Why, here's a filthy mean creature to sit on a throne. If I had known as much of him before as I know today, I don't doubt I should have given cause to be where I am now." And then on a sudden thought, "And where will Lord Gildoy be, do you suppose?" he asked. Young Pitt, whom he addressed, turned towards him a face from which the ruddy tan of the sea had faded almost completely during those months of captivity. His grey eyes were round and questioning. Blood answered him, "Sure now, we've never seen his lordship since that day at Oglethorpe's. And where are the other gentry that were taken, the real leaders of this plaguey rebellion? Grey's case explains their absence, I think. They are wealthy men that can ransom themselves. Here awaiting the gallows are none but the unfortunates who followed. Those who had the honour to lead them go free. It's a curious and instructive reversal of the usual way of these things. Faith, it's an uncertain world entirely." He laughed, and settled down into that spirit of scorn, wrapped in which he stepped later into the great hall of Taunton Castle to take his trial. With him went Pitt and the yeoman Baines. The three of them were to be tried together, and their case was to open the proceedings of that ghastly day. The hall, even to the galleries, thronged with spectators, most of whom were ladies, was hung in scarlet, a pleasant conceit this of the Lord Chief Justice's, who naturally enough preferred the colour that should reflect his own bloody mind. At the upper end, on a raised dais, sat the Lord's commissioners, the five judges in their scarlet robes and heavy dark periwigs, Baron Jeffreys of Wem, enthroned in the middle place. The prisoners filed in under guard. The crier called for silence under pain of imprisonment, and as the hum of voices gradually became hushed, Mr. Blood considered with interest the 12 good men and true that composed the jury. Neither good nor true did they look. They were scared, uneasy, and hangdog as any set of thieves caught with their hands in the pockets of their neighbors. They were 12 shaken men, each of whom stood between the sword of the Lord Chief Justice's recent bloodthirsty charge and the wall of his own conscience. From them, Mr. Blood's calm, deliberate glance passed on to consider the Lord's commissioners, and particularly the presiding judge, that Lord Jeffreys, whose terrible fame had come ahead of him from Dorchester. He beheld a tall, slight man on the young side of 40, with an oval face that was delicately beautiful. There were dark stains of suffering or sleeplessness under the low, lidded eyes, heightening their brilliance and their gentle melancholy. The face was very pale, save for the vivid color of the full lips and the hectic flush on the rather high but inconspicuous cheekbones. It was something in those lips that marred the perfection of that countenance. A fault, elusive and undeniable, lurked there to belie the fine sensitiveness of those nostrils, the tenderness of those dark, liquid eyes, and the noble calm of that pale brow. The physician in Mr. Blood regarded the man with peculiar interest, knowing, as he did, the agonizing malady from which his lordship suffered,
and the amazingly irregular, debauched life
that he led in spite of it, perhaps because of it.
Peter Blood, hold up your hand.
Abruptly he was recalled to his position by the harsh voice of the clerk of arraigns. His obedience was mechanical, and the clerk droned out the wordy indictment, which pronounced Peter Blood a false traitor against the most illustrious and most excellent prince, James II, by the grace of God of England, Scotland, France, and Ireland, king, his supreme and natural lord. It informed him that, having no fear of God in his heart, but being moved and seduced by the instigation of the devil, he had failed in the love and true and due natural obedience towards this said lord and king, and had moved to disturb the peace and tranquillity of the kingdom and to stir up war and rebellion to depose his said lord the king from the title, honor, and the regal name of the imperial crown, and much more of the same kind. At the end of all of which, he was invited to say whether he was guilty or not guilty. He answered more than was asked. "It's entirely innocent I am." A small, sharp-faced man, at a table before and to the right of him, bounced up.
It was Mr. Pollexfen,
the judge advocate. "Are you guilty or not guilty?" snapped this peppery gentleman. "You must take the words." "Words, is it?" said Peter Blood. "Oh, not guilty." And he went on, addressing himself to the bench. "On this same subject of words, may it please your lordships, I am guilty of nothing to justify any of those words I have heard used to describe me, unless it be of a want of patience at having been closely confined for 2 months and longer in a fetid jail with great peril to my health and even life." Being started, he would have added a deal more, but at this point the Lord Chief Justice interposed in a gentle, rather plaintive voice.
"Look you, sir, because we must observe the common and usual methods of trial, I must interrupt you now. You are no doubt ignorant of the forms of law."
"Not only ignorant, my lord, but hitherto most happy in that ignorance. I could gladly have foregone this acquaintance with them." A pale smile momentarily lighted the wistful countenance.
"I believe you. You shall be fully heard when you come to your defense, but anything you say now is altogether irregular and improper."
Enheartened by that apparent sympathy and consideration, Mr. Blood answered thereafter, as was required of him, that he would be tried by God and his country. Whereupon, having prayed to God to send him a good deliverance, the clerk called upon Andrew Baines to hold up his hand and plead. From Baines, who pleaded not guilty, the clerk passed on to Pitt, who boldly owned his guilt. The Lord Chief Justice stirred at that.
"Come, that's better," quoth he,
and his four scarlet brethren nodded.
"If all were as obstinate as his two fellow rebels, there would never be an end."
After that ominous interpolation, delivered with an inhuman iciness that sent a shiver through the court,
Mr. Pollexfen got to his feet.
With great prolixity, he stated the general case against the three men and the particular case against Peter Blood, whose indictment was to be taken first. The only witness called for the king was Captain Hobart. He testified briskly to the manner in which he had found and taken the three prisoners, together with Lord Gildoy. Upon the orders of his colonel, he would have hanged Pitt out of hand, but was restrained by the lies of the prisoner Blood, who led him to believe that Pitt was a peer of the realm and a person of consideration. As the captain's evidence concluded, Lord Jeffreys looked across at Peter Blood.
"Will the prisoner Blood ask the witness any questions?"
"None, my lord. He has correctly related what occurred." I'm glad to have your admission of that without any of the prevarications that are usual in your kind. And I will say this, that here, prevarication would avail you little. For we always have the truth in the end. Be sure of that.
Baines and Pitt similarly admitted the accuracy of the captain's evidence, whereupon the scarlet figure of the Lord Chief Justice heaved a sigh of relief.
This being so, let us go on in God's name, for we have much to do.
There was now no trace of gentleness in his voice. It was brisk and rasping, and the lips through which it passed were curved in scorn.
I take it, Mr. Pollexfen, that the wicked treason of these three rogues being established indeed admitted by them, there is no more to be said.
Peter Blood's voice rang out crisply on a note that almost seemed to contain laughter.
May it please your lordship, but there's a deal more to be said.
His lordship looked at him, first in blank amazement at his audacity, then gradually with an expression of dull anger. The scarlet lips fell into unpleasant, cruel lines that transfigured the whole countenance.
How now, rogue? Would you waste our time with idle subterfuge?
I would have your lordship and the gentlemen of the jury hear me on my defense, as your lordship promised that I should be heard.
Why, so you shall, villain. So you shall.
His lordship's voice was harsh as a file. He writhed as he spoke, and for an instant his features were distorted. A delicate, dead-white hand, on which the veins showed blue, brought forth a handkerchief with which he dabbed his lips and then his brow. Observing him with the physician's eye, Peter Blood judged him a prey to the pain of the disease that was destroying him.
So you shall. But after the admission made, what defense remains?
You shall judge, my lord.
That is the purpose for which I sit here.
And so shall you, gentlemen.
Blood looked from judge to jury. The latter shifted uncomfortably under the confident flash of his blue eyes. Lord Jeffrey's bullying charge had whipped the spirit out of them. Had they themselves been prisoners accused of treason, he could not have arraigned them more ferociously. Peter Blood stood boldly forward, erect, self-possessed, and saturnine. He was freshly shaven, and his periwig, if out of curl, was at least carefully combed and dressed.
Captain Hobart has testified to what he knows, that he found me at Oglethorpe's farm on the Monday morning after the battle at Weston, but he has not told you what I did there.
Again the judge broke in.
Why, what should you have been doing there in the company of rebels? Two of them, Lord Gildoy and your fellow there, have already admitted their guilt.
That is what I beg leave to tell your lordship.
I pray do, and in God's name be brief, man. For if I am to be troubled with the say of all you traitor dogs, I may sit here until the spring assizes.
I was there, my lord, in my quality as a physician, to dress Lord Gildoy's wounds.
What's this? Do you tell us that you're a physician?
A graduate of Trinity College, Dublin.
Good God!
Cried Lord Jeffreys, his voice suddenly swelling, his eyes upon the jury.
What an impudent rogue is this! You heard the witness say that he had known him in Tangiers some years ago, and that he was then an officer in the French service. You heard the prisoner admit that the witness had spoken the truth?
Why, so he had. Yet what I am telling you is also true, so it is. For some years I was a soldier, but before that I was a physician, and I have been one again since January last, established in Bridgwater, as I can bring 100 witnesses to prove.
There's no need to waste our time with that, and I will convict you out of your own rascally mouth. I will ask you only this. How came you, who represent yourself as a physician peacefully following your calling in the town of Bridgwater, to be with the army of the Duke of Monmouth?
I was never with that army. No witness has sworn to that, and I dare swear that no witness will. I never was attracted to the late rebellion. I regarded the adventure as a wicked madness. I take leave to ask your lordship.
His brogue became more marked than ever.
What should I, who is born and bred a papist, be doing in the army of the Protestant champion?
A papist, thou?
The judge gloomed on him a moment. Art more like a snivelling, canting Jack Presbyter, I tell you, man. I can smell a Presbyterian 40 miles.
Then I'll take leave to marvel that with so keen a nose, your lordship can't smell a papist at 4 paces.
There was a ripple of laughter in the galleries, instantly quelled by the fierce glare of the judge and the voice of the crier. Lord Jeffreys leaned farther forward upon his desk. He raised that delicate white hand, still clutching his handkerchief and sprouting from a froth of lace.
"We'll leave your religion out of account for the moment, friend," said he. "But mark what I say to you."
With a minatory forefinger, he beat the time of his words.
"Know, friend, that there is no religion a man can pretend to, can give a countenance to lying. Thou hast a precious immortal soul, and there is nothing in the world equal to it in value. Consider that the great God of heaven and earth, before whose tribunal thou and we and all persons are to stand at the last day, will take vengeance on thee for every falsehood, and justly strike thee into eternal flames, make thee drop into the bottomless pit of fire and brimstone, if thou offer to deviate the least from the truth and nothing but the truth. For I tell thee, God is not mocked. On that I charge you to answer truthfully. How came you to be taken with these rebels?"
Peter Blood gaped at him a moment in consternation. The man was incredible, unreal, fantastic, a nightmare judge. Then he collected himself to answer.
"I was summoned that morning to succor Lord Gildoy, and I considered it to be the duty imposed upon me by my calling to answer that summons."
"Did you so?"
The judge, terrible now in aspect, his face white, his twisted lips red as the blood for which they thirsted, glared upon him in evil mockery. Then he controlled himself as if by an effort. He sighed. He resumed his earlier gentle plaintiveness.
"Lord, how you waste our time! But I'll have patience with you. Who summoned you?"
"Master Pitt here, as he will testify."
"Oh, Master Pitt will testify. He that is himself a traitor self-confessed. Is that your witness?"
"There is also Master Baines here, who can answer to it."
"Good Master Baines will have to answer for himself, and I doubt not he'll be greatly exercised to save his own neck from a halter. Come, come, sir. Are those your only witnesses?"
"I could bring others from Bridgwater, who saw me set out that morning upon the crupper of Master Pitt's horse."
His lordship smiled.
"It will not be necessary. For mark me, I do not intend to waste more time on you. Answer me only this. When Master Pitt, as you pretend, came to summon you, did you know that he had been, as you have heard him confess, of Monmouth's following?"
"I did, my lord."
"You did? Ha!"
His lordship looked at the cringing jury and uttered a short, stabbing laugh.
"Yet in spite of that, you went with him?"
"To succor a wounded man, as was my sacred duty."
"Thy sacred duty, sayest thou?"
Fury blazed out from him again.
"Good God! What a generation of vipers do we live in! Thy sacred duty, rogue, is to thy king and to God! But let it pass. Did he tell you whom it was that you were destined to succor?"
"Lord Gildoy, yes."
"And you knew that Lord Gildoy had been wounded in the battle, and on what side he fought?"
"I knew."
"And yet, being, as you would have us believe, a true and loyal subject of our lord the king, you went to succor him?"
Peter Blood lost his patience for a moment.
"My business, my lord, was with his wounds, not with his politics."
A murmur from the galleries, and even from the jury, approved him. It served only to drive his terrible judge into a deeper fury.
"Jesus God! Was there ever such an impudent villain in the world as thou?"
He swung white-faced to the jury.
"I hope, gentlemen of the jury, you take notice of the horrible carriage of this traitor rogue. And withal, you cannot but observe the spirit of this sort of people, what a villainous and devilish one it is. Out of his own mouth, he has said enough to hang him 12 times. Yet is there more? Answer me this, sir. When you cozened Captain Hobart with your lies concerning the station of this other traitor Pitt, what
was your business then?
To save him from being hanged without trial, as was threatened.
What concern was it of yours, whether or how the wretch was hanged?
Justice is the common concern of every loyal subject, for an injustice committed by one who holds the king's commission is in some sense a dishonour to the king's majesty. It was a shrewd, sharp thrust aimed at the jury, and it reveals, I think, the alertness of the man's mind, his self-possession ever steadiest in moments of dire peril. With any other jury, it must have made the impression that he hoped to make. It may even have made its impression upon these poor pusillanimous sheep. But the dread judge was there to efface it. He gasped aloud, then flung himself violently forward.
"Lord of heaven!" he stormed. "Was there ever such a canting, impudent rascal? But I have done with you. I see thee, villain. I see thee already with a halter round thy neck."
Having spoken so, gloatingly, evilly, he sank back again and composed himself. It was as if a curtain fell. All emotion passed again from his pale face. Back to invest it again came that gentle melancholy. Speaking after a moment's pause, his voice was soft, almost tender, yet every word of it carried sharply through that hushed court.
"If I know my own heart, it is not in my nature to desire the hurt of anybody, much less to delight in its eternal perdition. It is out of compassion for you that I have used all these words, because I would have you have some regard for your immortal soul, and not ensure its damnation by obdurately persisting in falsehood and prevarication. But I see that all the pains in the world and all the compassion and charity are lost upon you, and therefore I will say no more to you."
He turned again to the jury that countenance of wistful beauty.
"Gentlemen, I must tell you for law, of which we are the judges, and not you, that if any person be in actual rebellion against the king, and another person, who really and actually was not in rebellion, does knowingly receive, harbour, comfort, or succour him, such a person is as much a traitor as he who indeed bore arms. We are bound by our oaths and consciences to declare to you what is law, and you are bound by your oaths and your consciences to deliver and to declare to us by your verdict the truth of the facts."
Upon that he proceeded to his summing up, showing how Baines and Blood were both guilty of treason, the first for having harbored a traitor, the second for having succored that traitor by dressing his wounds. He interlarded his addresses by sycophantic allusions to his natural lord and lawful sovereign, the king, whom God had set over them, and with vituperations of nonconformity and of Monmouth, of whom, in his own words, he dared boldly affirm that the meanest subject within the kingdom that was of legitimate birth had a better title to the crown.
"Jesus God, that ever we should have such a generation of vipers among us!"
he burst out in rhetorical frenzy. And then he sank back as if exhausted by the violence he had used. A moment he was still, dabbing his lips again. Then he moved uneasily. Once more his features were twisted by pain. And in a few snarling, almost incoherent words, he dismissed the jury to consider the verdict. Peter Blood had listened to the intemperate, the blasphemous, and almost obscene invective of that tirade with a detachment that afterwards, in retrospect, surprised him. He was so amazed by the man, by the reactions taking place in him between mind and body, and by his methods of bullying and coercing the jury into bloodshed, that he almost forgot that his own life was at stake. The absence of that dazed jury was a brief one. The verdict found the three prisoners guilty. Peter Blood looked round the scarlet-hung court. For an instant, that foam of white faces seemed to heave before him. Then he was himself again, and a voice was asking him what he had to say for himself, why sentence of death should not be passed upon him, being convicted of high treason. He laughed, and his laugh
jarred uncannily upon the deathly stillness of the court. It was also grotesque, such a mockery of justice administered by that wistful-eyed Jack Pudding in scarlet, who was himself a mockery, the venal instrument of a brutally spiteful and vindictive king. His laughter shocked the austerity of that same Jack Pudding. "Do you laugh, sirrah, with a rope about your neck, upon the very threshold of that eternity you are so suddenly to enter into?" And then Blood took his revenge. "Faith, it's in better case I am for mirth than your lordship, for I have this to say before you deliver judgment. Your lordship sees me, an innocent man, whose only offence is that I practised charity with a halter round my neck. Your lordship, being the justiciar, speaks with knowledge of what is to come to me. I, being a physician, may speak with knowledge of what is to come to your lordship. And I tell you that I would not now change places with you, that I would not exchange this halter that you fling about my neck for the stone that you carry in your body. The death to which you may doom me is a light pleasantry, by contrast, with the death to which your lordship has been doomed by that great judge with whose name your lordship makes so free." The Lord Chief Justice sat stiffly upright, his face ashen, his lips twitching, and whilst you may have counted 10, there was no sound in that paralyzed court after Peter Blood had finished speaking. All those who knew Lord Jeffreys regarded this as the lull before the storm and braced themselves for the explosion. But none came. Slowly, faintly, the color crept back into that ashen face. The scarlet figure lost its rigidity and bent forward. His lordship began to speak, in a muted voice and briefly, much more briefly than is wont on such occasions, and in a manner entirely mechanical, the manner of a man whose thoughts are elsewhere while his lips are speaking. He delivered the sentence of death in the prescribed form, and without the least allusion to what Peter Blood had said. Having delivered it, he sank back, exhausted, his eyes half closed, his brows agleam with sweat. The prisoners filed out. Mr. Pollexfen, a Whig at heart, despite the position of judge advocate which he occupied, was overheard by one of the jurors to mutter in the ear of a brother counsel, "On my soul, that swarthy rascal has given his lordship a scare. It's a pity he must hang, for a man who can frighten Jeffreys should go far." Chapter 4. Human Merchandise. Mr. Pollexfen was at one and the same time right and wrong, a condition much more common than is generally supposed. He was right in his indifferently expressed thought that a man whose mien and words could daunt such a lord of terror as Jeffreys should by the dominance of his nature be able to fashion himself a considerable destiny. He was wrong, though justifiably so, in his assumption that Peter Blood must hang. I have said that the tribulations with which he was visited as a result of his errand of mercy to Oglethorpe's farm contained, although as yet he did not perceive it, perhaps, two sources of thankfulness. One, that he was tried at all. The other, that his trial took place on the 19th of September. Until the 18th, the sentences passed by the court of the Lord's Commissioners had been carried out literally and expeditiously. But on the morning of the 19th, there arrived at Taunton a courier from Lord Sunderland, the Secretary of State, with a letter for Lord Jeffreys wherein he was informed that His Majesty had been graciously pleased to command that 1,100 rebels should be furnished for transportation to some of His Majesty's southern plantations, Jamaica, Barbados, or any of the Leeward Islands. You are not to suppose that this command was dictated by any sense of mercy. Lord Churchill was no more than just when he spoke of the king's heart as being as insensible as marble. It had been realized that in these wholesale hangings there was taking place a reckless waste of valuable material. Slaves were urgently required in the plantations, and a healthy, vigorous man could be reckoned worth at least from 10 to 15 pounds. Then there were at court many gentlemen who had some claim or other upon His Majesty's bounty. Here was a cheap and ready way to discharge these claims. From amongst the convicted rebels, a certain number might be set aside to be bestowed upon those gentlemen so that they might dispose of them to their own profit. My Lord Sunderland's letter gives precise details of the royal munificence in human flesh. 1,000 prisoners were to be distributed among some 8 courtiers and others, whilst a postscriptum to his lordship's letter asked for a further 100 to be held at the disposal of the Queen. These prisoners to be transported at once to His Majesty's southern plantations and to be kept there for the space of 10 years before being restored to liberty, the parties to whom they were assigned entering into security to see that transportation was immediately effected. We know from Lord Jeffrey's secretary how the Chief Justice inveighed that night in drunken frenzy against this misplayed clemency to which His Majesty had been persuaded. We know how he attempted by letter to induce the King to reconsider his decision, but James adhered to it. It was, apart from the indirect profit he derived from it, a clemency full worthy of him. He knew that to spare lives in this fashion was to convert them into living deaths. Many must succumb in torment to the horrors of West Indian slavery, and so be the envy of their surviving companions. Thus it happened that Peter Blood, and with him Jeremy Pitt and Andrew Baines, instead of being hanged, drawn, and quartered as their sentences directed, were conveyed to Bristol, and there shipped with some 50 others aboard the Jamaica Merchant. From close confinement under hatches, ill nourishment, and foul water, a sickness broke out amongst them, of which 11 died. Amongst these was the unfortunate yeoman from Oglethorpe's farm, brutally torn from his quiet homestead amid the fragrant cider orchards for no other sin than that he had practiced mercy. The mortality might have been higher than it was, but for Peter Blood. At first, the master of the Jamaica Merchant had answered with oaths and threats the doctor's expostulations against permitting men to perish in this fashion, and his insistence that he should be made free of the medicine chest and given leave to minister to the sick. But presently Captain Gardner came to see that he might be brought to task for these 2 heavy losses of human merchandise, and because of this he was belatedly glad to avail himself of the skill of Peter Blood. The doctor went to work zealously and zestfully, and wrought so ably that, by his ministrations and by improving the conditions of his fellow captives, he checked the spread of the disease. Towards the middle of December, the Jamaica Merchant dropped anchor in Carlisle Bay and put ashore the 42 surviving rebels convict. If these unfortunates had imagined, as many of them appear to have done, that they were coming into some wild, savage country, the prospect, of which they had a glimpse before they were hustled over the ship's side into the waiting boats, was enough to correct the impression. They beheld a town of sufficiently imposing proportions, composed of houses built upon European notions of architecture, but without any of the huddle usual in European cities. The spire of a church rose dominantly among the red roofs. A fort guarded the entrance of the wide harbor, with guns thrusting their muzzles between the crenels, and the wide facade of Government House revealed itself dominantly, placed on a gentle hill above the town. This hill was vividly green, as is an English hill in April, and the day was such a day as April gives to England, the season of heavy rains being newly ended. On a wide, cobbled space on the seafront, they found a guard of red-coated militia drawn up to receive them, and a crowd, attracted by their arrival, which in dress and manner differed little from a crowd in a seaport at home, save that it contained fewer women and a greater number of negroes. To inspect them, drawn up there on the mole, came Governor Steed, a short, stout, red-faced gentleman in blue taffetas burdened by a prodigious amount of gold lace, who limped a little and leaned heavily upon a stout ebony cane. After him, in the uniform of a colonel of the Barbados militia, rolled a tall, corpulent man who towered head and shoulders above the governor, with malevolence plainly written on his enormous, yellowish countenance. At his side, and contrasting oddly with his grossness, moving with an easy, stripling grace, came a slight young lady in a modish riding gown. The broad brim of a gray hat with a scarlet sweep of ostrich plume shaded an oval face, upon which the climate of the Tropic of Cancer had made no impression, so delicately fair was its complexion. Ringlets of red-brown hair hung to her shoulders. Frankness looked out from her hazel eyes, which were set wide. Commiseration repressed now the mischievousness that normally inhabited her fresh young mouth. Peter Blood caught himself staring in a sort of amazement at that piquant face, which seemed here so out of place, and finding his stare returned, he shifted uncomfortably. He grew conscious of the sorry figure that he cut, unwashed, with rank and matted hair and a disfiguring black beard upon his face, and the erstwhile splendid suit of black camlet in which he had been taken prisoner, now reduced to rags that would have disgraced a scarecrow. He was in no case for inspection by such dainty eyes as these. Nevertheless, they continued to inspect him with round-eyed, almost childlike wonder and pity. Their owner put forth a hand to touch the scarlet sleeve of her companion, whereupon, with an ill-tempered grunt, the man swung his great bulk round so that he directly confronted her. Looking up into his face, she was speaking to him earnestly, but the colonel plainly gave her no more than the half of his attention. His little beady eyes, closely flanking a fleshly, pendulous nose, had passed from her and were fixed upon fair-haired, sturdy young Pitt, who was standing beside Blood. The governor had also come to a halt, and for a moment, now that the little group of three stood in conversation. What the lady said Peter could not hear at all, for she lowered her voice. The colonel's reached him in a confused rumble, but the governor was neither considerate nor indistinct. He had a high-pitched voice, which carried far, and, believing himself witty, he desired to be heard by all. "But my dear Colonel Bishop, it is for you to take first choice from this dainty nosegay at your own price. After that, we'll send the rest to auction." Colonel Bishop nodded his acknowledgement. He raised his voice in answering,
"Your Excellency is very good. But faith, they're a weedy lot. Not likely to be of much value in the plantation."
His beady eyes scanned them again, and his contempt of them deepened the malevolence of his face. It was as if he were annoyed with them for being in no better condition. Then he beckoned forward Captain Gardner, the master of the Jamaica merchant, and for some minutes stood in talk with him over a list which the latter produced at his request. Presently he waved aside the list and advanced alone towards the rebel's convict, his eyes considering them, his lips pursed. Before the young Somersetshire shipmaster, he came to a halt and stood an instant pondering him. Then he fingered the muscles of the young man's arm and bade him open his mouth that he might see his teeth. He pursed his coarse lips again and nodded. He spoke to Gardner over his shoulder.
£15 for this one."
The captain made a face of dismay. £15? It isn't half what I meant to ask for him."
"It is double what I'd meant to give,"
grunted the colonel. "But he would be cheap at £30, Your Honor."
"I can get a negro for that. These white swine don't live. They're not fit for the labor."
Gardner broke into protestation of Pitt's health, youth, and vigor. It was not a man he was discussing. It was a beast of burden. Pitt, a sensitive lad, stood mute and unmoving. Only the ebb and flow of color in his cheeks showed the inward struggle by which he maintained his self-control. Peter Blood was nauseated by the loathsome haggle. In the background, moving slowly away down the line of prisoners.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.